Day America. Stand by for news. Paul Harvey.
Yeah, that was his deal. Yeah, I know.
I'm Jack Rickard with EVTV. This is my compadre and consigliere, El Brain Noto.
Hey, it's good to be here.
What do you know, Brain?
Well, I do know that it's Friday, and it's really Friday.
It's really Friday.
It's been raining here in Missouri. It's been kind of icky.
We've had a week.
Yeah. Yep. It's been kind of icky.
What have you heard?
Well, let's see. I'm trying to think. Well, you know what? You know, we ex-Volkswagen guys. You know, I started in the publishing business in, 1986, I guess, with VW Trends magazine. I worked my way through a bunch of illustrious automotive and power sports journals, motorcycle journals, most with girls in bikinis on the cover.
Well, in your fourth or fifth incursion of working for me, you brought with you a Ghia.
I brought that Karmann Ghia, yeah, last year, that 74
that
Karmann
Ghia.
That
was a fully restored. What kind of engine did you have in that?
I had a 2165cc engine, was completely hand-built by me with 48 Webers, close-ratio transmission. It was painted Ravenna green originally, and it was Ravenna green when I did it, and it was... I built it in, 2003, in 3 months, just to see if I still had it in me, in my garage.
It's a gorgeous car. I'm still kind of thrown that you traded it on a goofy motorcycle.
It would have been electric already.
Yeah, it would have been electric by now. But I used to drive a VW microbus.
I remember that you told me about the microbus, and I remember your van again. We drove in the snow with no windshield wipers.
That was the pickle. The microbus. I traded the microbus on a Vanagon so I'd have a heater.
That's right. Yeah.
Because the Vanagons were water heated, and the microbus wasn't.
No,
but
they're cool.
Never did like that Vanagon the way I liked the microbus.
Yeah.
It was all vinyl seats and rubber mats.
Yeah.
And I could pile all the neighborhood kids and all my kids, which I had four at the time, when they were little, into that thing, and off to the Dairy Queen we'd go. And they could write their names in the car with ice cream. And when we got back, I just turned the hose in one window and flushed it.
And flush it out. That's right. They're great for that.
It was a flushable automobile. I love the microbus.
You got to love that.
What are they doing now?
Well, VW, I guess at the Geneva Auto Show, has brought out what they're calling the Bully, at least for right now, B-U-L-L-I, and it is their microbus version. It's a concept vehicle. I'd like to see them do it. They do have a cool thing, though. The iPad has a docking station, and it is your stereo. It's all your gauges, everything. It looks pretty cool. I do like the concept of the new VW microbus that they've, I would like to see them do it.
Steve Jobs announced the new iPad.
The new iPad this week, yeah.
Twice the speed, a third less weight, and it's thinner than the iPhone 4.
Oh, man.
The problem I have with the iPad is software development kit kind of locks you out of the Bluetooth, so I'm not sure how they're using all this. Apparently, you have to use a docking
port
or
something. Yeah, I think so.
To be able to do it, I want to be able to throw it up on the dash and have it get the data over Bluetooth. And they've got us locked out of that for some goofy reason having to do with digital rights management and iTunes, which I got no interest in. And
who cares?
So that's that. But the Bully looks very good.
It does.
And they're talking, actually, about an EV version with 186-mile range, a software-limited top speed of 87 miles an hour. And that would be quite a little vehicle.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Four-door bus with cargo in the back. I could... spring for something like that.
Yeah, look like a nice vehicle. Yep.
The Geneva Auto Show ought to be called the EV Coming Out Party.
Oh, can you believe it?
It seems to almost be entirely devoted to electric vehicles. Perhaps that's my filter. But everything I'm reading is about new ones. The dangerous one, the 800-pound gorilla in space, I am already going to declare the winner. And they don't even have an electric car, really, is BMW.
Oh, okay, with their eye?
They have the successor to the Mini Cooper, which is going to be imminent. And then they have an i3 called the Mega City that's going into carbon fiber.
Oh, man.
A very sleek, aerodynamic thing. I think it's going to be pretty performance. BMW is probably the closest to my concept of how electric cars will be introduced. That's on the upper end.
Yes, that's a burn car, yep.
Kind of a performance model and something that would appeal very strongly to a well-heeled early adopter.
Yes.
Obviously, I think Tesla is in that space as well.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, I had called for a bloodbath in the economy of model concept of an electric car.
Right.
I suppose it's too early to declare a victory, but
you gonna do it anyway?
Yeah, you know I'm not. I'm just gonna report some figures here that I found interesting.
Let our viewers sort it out for themselves.
With gasoline today at $3.47 a gallon nationally.
Yes.
Oil's $103 for WTI and $115 for. Light sweet.
For some good
Brent.
Light sweet.
Yeah. Oh, some light sweet, yes. In January, General Motors sold 321 volts.
Okay.
In February, they sold 281. I guess it's three fewer days.
Yeah. That's three fewer days.
To date, they have sold 928 volts, and there is already kind of a cult development of anti-GMites over the dealer behavior.
Oh, really?
They're marking up the $41,000 MSRP to at least $45,000, and in the case of one Florida dealer, $65,000.
Just a little. They put that in. They probably are so bold to put a line there that says extra profit.
Right, right, right. And it's incensed some of the devotees. Leaf sold 87 in January and 67 in February for a total of 173 cars. This is
holy
some
moly.
People that are claiming to. To be gearing up for $150,000 a year. GM had announced they're increasing their production plans to $110,000 in 2011.
Okay.
And so far they've sold 928 of them.
Yeah, they'll have a little overcapacity at this rate.
Now, I don't know if it's because they can't produce them, can't ship them, or if it's people aren't buying them, but I still don't quite get an economy car at twice the price.
Yeah, at a premium, double premium, yeah.
Is to appeal to who? If I was in a position in life where a Nissan Leaf or a Chevrolet Volt would appeal to me, why wouldn't I also, in the same position, have to opt for the 35 or 40 mile per gallon version with an internal combustion engine at half the price.
Half the price, yeah, at least for right now. Yeah.
By definition, the economy end of the car market is ruled by people that can't afford bigger cars or better cars.
Yeah, they want an economy car, yeah.
And that's, we've all been there.
Yeah. Amazing.
It's kind of one of the phases you go through is... you know, you have to have an inexpensive and very flexible car that'll carry a couple little kids.
Right,
and
right.
Thank goodness we're past it.
Yes, thank you.
But I don't understand that approach.
Yeah, me either.
But BMW and Tesla,
yes.
I do understand, and I think they'll do well if the media doesn't just spank Nissan and GM so hard. And the sort of counter stories are already starting to come out that it makes the whole electric car thing look goofy.
Yeah. Wow.
And what I really want is for GM to jump up and then say, see, we told you there wasn't any market for an electric car.
Yes, right. That'll be their next plan.
After introducing an electric car that runs on gasoline.
Yes. And Nissan makes sure.
The more extreme end of that, but the one that would work, is Rolls-Royce has opened a dialogue.
Oh, okay, a dialogue.
A dialogue.
Dialogue. Don't touch them. They'll
electric
do it to
cars. Me. Let's take a look. I've got a little clip of it.
All right. Cool.
And so that's the okay. Rolls-Royce
that's the other end, yeah.
thing.
Wow.
And now you kind of have to pre-order a Rolls-Royce anyway.
Yeah.
They've been around for 100 years, and they're a good example that you can make custom quality cars and pull it off.
Yes.
You have to be able to build the brand and for people to recognize it as quality. They do about 2,400 cars a year.
Yeah, and by hand, yeah, that's.
And I would say by the end of their dialogue, they'll have two or three orders. It's so such an obvious thing.
Yeah.
There'll be some limo companies, if nothing else.
Just put
in an order for that.
That's right. We saw the Academy Awards
last
week.
Yes, they want to pull up to the carpet in an electric Rolls Royce. Yeah. That would work pretty well.
That's right. You can still have your Rolls Royce, but
this
the
is
electric.
A no-brainer. And how many they build don't matter. They're all going to be custom cars.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of interesting. We got in a new toy here.
We did. We got our new 650 amp 7601 Curtis controller.
Mm-hmm.
So our three-phase controller came in. They said it was going to be available
February 1st to March,
and today they hit it. Yeah.
I have just seen nothing but stellar performance out of these HP EVS guys.
Yeah, they're really great guys.
They've been really wrapped around an axle working with those WeGo.
With the WeGo, yeah.
Guys, and they're still taking care of business and very professionally.
Yeah.
The 7501 is what we were using. It had it was ostensibly a 96 volt controller.
Yeah, which is what they're specing this one at.
I'm told the top voltage that it will bear is 130.
Yes, I believe so.
And
yes.
We operate it in both the Spider and Speedster Dove very successfully and without any anomalies, really.
No.
At 120 volts. But it's limited to 550 amperes of current. And so that's about, with that combination, I think we were measuring 65, 66 horsepower.
Yes, yeah.
This is the new 7601.
7601, yeah.
I'm hoping it's exactly identical because I want to swap it out in Speedster Dove.
Yes. Yeah, let's see what it does.
Do a dynamometer again with the 7501 and then do a quick change on it to the 7601 and go back to Vienna and dynamometer again.
See what it does, yeah. That'd be great.
And that'll be fun.
Yep.
And so what are they charging for these now?
$2,400 retail.
Okay.
You know, of course, they want to sell their packages. I mean, they're still at, you know, $4,600 bucks for a motor and controller if you were buying the 7601.
Mm-hmm.
They're great guys out there. We know the product. It's kind of bulletproof.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just having fun out there at HP EVS.
Well, everybody's looking for the AC solution. This is it. It's this thing's bulletproof and easy to configure, and it works. It's been somewhat limited in power.
Yes.
550 to 650, we should be seeing 18, 20% increase in power. And that would be very welcome.
Yes.
At that end of it. And that puts us at, I'm going to be looking for another 15 horsepower.
Yeah, 15 horsepower, maybe 110 foot-pounds of torque.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we should, we'll run it out there and see what we get and, report back to everybody.
Rumors still abound of a higher voltage version as well.
Mm-hmm.
144 volt controller would be
that put them in a sweet spot.
Cool.
Yeah, that put them right in a sweet spot.
And so it's it doesn't scratch the 200 kilowatt itch to build your own Tesla at home.
No,
but it does regenerative braking. It has all the advantages of AC. Again, the Curtises require cooling. If you think they don't, you're going to be disappointed. You can blow them up. But we did a chill plate for this basic form factor that you can still get through
Cape Precision Machine, yes.
And I think they were about $800, but that lets you liquid cool that thing in the flat bottom. It works very well with
it. Yeah, it works really well. It just
the spider,
right up,
Wayne did that one with a mounting plate that was
major air
long.
Sink, yeah.
And
major heat sink
cut in it, and that worked pretty well. So if you can, if you've got room to simply heat sink it, that works pretty well too. But we'll keep you posted on how that comes out.
Absolutely.
I am discouraged to announce, and I really normally don't announce these things. We fail on a number of things. I don't think you have a whole lot of interest in what doesn't work. But I've been working with this charger so long, I got to get a story out of it.
It's been a long time.
We ordered this in August from some people, and I actually put it to the salesman. I said, man, I look at so much of this stuff that's unobtainium. Are you actually shipping the charger? Is it in production? Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can have you one in 2 weeks. That was in August. I got it in October.
Yeah, that was probably the end of October, yeah.
And then it was the wrong one.
That's right.
They have four variants, actually. The one you can get high and low voltage. I wanted the low voltage. He sent me the high.
That's right. We got the high voltage.
And then you have air or water cooled. And I did get the air cooled. Mm-hmm. It's an attractive notion. It's they're not giving it away. They're asking $2,850 for this.
Yes.
It's called Current Ways Technology. It's really LTH or LTV. Power supplies.
Power, yeah.
They have fallen in somehow with Flux Power and the president of Aptera, which is already another failed company. The Current Ways promised to be a programmable, fully programmable charger that you could also parallel.
Okay.
They're only 3 kilowatts, which is a little weenie for something that price. But I'd have preferred to see 3.5 or 4 kilowatts. But it was a 3 kilowatt programmable charger.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The first problem, they sent it to me, and it uses a CAN bus to do the programming and a program on your PC.
Mm-hmm.
Told the guy I didn't have a CAN bus adapter, and he advised me to go buy one. The CAN bus is fairly unusual as a configuration port They normally have a serial port, almost all of them. The Soliton has an Ethernet jack, but everybody can run a browser. A USB to serial port is pretty common, but you know, when they introduced them,
man, they were bad.
One would work and one wouldn't, and it depended on the software and the match.
Yeah.
The USB to CAN bus adapters are currently in the same state. It's chaos, and nothing actually works with anything else. And so I told him, you will provide me a CAN bus because we're going to be using the same adapter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
And
whatever
you use is just what I want.
That's right.
But I think you ought to provide it with your chargers anyway, because most of the people you're going to sell it to aren't going to have it.
They don't know. Not going to have it. Yeah.
Incredibly, he did send me a CAN bus adapter, and therein lies the tale. I got it, and it worked fine, by the way. And I was able to bring up their software. Unfortunately, their software was so hideously bad, I was in tears.
I know. I watched.
Worse, the charger, they missed some basics. They were simply measuring the voltage of the battery pack inside the charger. And, of course, it would be completely different if the batteries, depending on how long the cable was and how much current they were running. And so it was entirely inaccurate. With its ability to do the constant current, constant voltage charge curve, it couldn't pick out the point. And in fact, in testing it, I kind of overcharged some cells just a little bit. I was standing right there and caught it, and then played with it and saw what was going on. They have stages. You can program them. And but it wouldn't go to the next stage because it didn't pick up on
the
voltage.
That's right, it was stuck,
And it still thinks it's at another voltage because of a 3 or 4 or even 5 volt disparity between what they think the voltage is and what your batteries think the voltage is. And this is a fairly amateurish mistake. A charger ought to. Basically, how most of them do it is... they actually shut off the charger.
Just for a
tenth of a second, and where there's no current flowing, and then measure the voltage and then flip it back on. You don't even know that it quit. And they'll do that periodically to, well, these guys didn't know about this. But the software was just a mess. Typos, misspelled things. The screens locking up, the computer locking up. I spent a couple of days with this thing.
Oh, yeah.
And wrote them up a big report on everything that I found there. The salesman, Scott Strominger, the whole time is assuring me it works fine. Scott, it doesn't work at all. It's not that it works fine. Where do you get such an idea? This is a mess. And I gave it to him, and he's still insisting that it works fine. But his engineer and his software guys called to find out exactly what I was talking about. We talked about it for an hour or two, and they took it very well and went to fix it. We sent the charger back, got the new version, which was the correct voltage.
Got the low voltage,
And with some new software, and we loaded it up and could not program it at all.
No.
Guess what the story was?
I haven't heard. I can't imagine.
I guess this just goes on so long they forget who they're talking to or what happened. Scott Strominger assured me that the charger works great, but my USB adapter is probably the wrong one.
Well, you got it from them.
Yeah. I thought that was kind of cunning that I'd done that.
That's right. Just take that
one
right
out. I did that so we'd be on the same page, so that wouldn't be one of the
take that one right out of off the table.
I said, Scott, you sent us this one. Well, we don't use that one now. We've gone to another one that works better.
Uh-oh.
Really? Well, we're not going to send you one of those. You have to buy that. He said the other thing is it doesn't really work with XP. You really need Windows 7. And probably your computer's messed up. That's why you're not able to run the software.
Not able to program. What?
I said, so all I need is a new CAN USB port adapter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
I've got one, but I need a different one.
Yeah, the one you sent me.
Right.
Yeah, doesn't Which work.
He didn't buy into any of this when I first went through this. But now they do see a difference in CAN USB bus. And I need a new PC with an upgraded operating system to run your charger. Then it will run fine. Oh, yeah, it runs good. I said, how does it do with an RMA number coming at you?
Yeah, that's right.
And he simply repeated that I get the CAN USB, but I finally wrote the president of the outfit and got a nice message from Scott telling me to send it in, and we'll send it back for a refund. But the thing was actually dangerous for lithium batteries when I last got it to talk to them. And a programmable charger that you can't program is of no use to me at all.
Yeah, take a couple grand off the price and
but I would treat it with care. There is no saving this charger, otherwise I'd keep working with them. They've gone on the bad attitude thing that, hey, we're fine and you're all messed up. We got chargers everywhere. Yeah, and I am all messed up. What's the news in that?
Yeah, come on, guys.
I'm where people send stuff to find out if it's messed up because they know where messed up lives.
That's right. Yeah, no problem here.
What planet are you dialing from? So anyway, we're going to send this back. I'm not going to spend any further time with it if they get into the, well, it's you've got the wrong PC and the wrong software and want to start into a email excuse game of who's on first. I don't have time, Scott. I'm sorry. We've got a lot of stuff we're fooling with. I was willing to work with you a little bit on this and trying to help you get it there, but I'm not really a beta test team, and I was making an exception in your case till the attitude went south. So we'll accept a check in lieu of, and we'll send this back to you.
All right.
Still not a really good charger option out there.
No.
It's
amazing.
One of the central holes in EV land is the struggle with chargers.
Yeah.
And frankly, the best I've found is the Brusa.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's been the most reliable, but it's at the end of a long supply chain. The problem with Victor is kind of started to break down. Bruce is starting to ship them to other people and through other people.
Oh, really?
And
okay.
So forth, yeah. But you're still at the way at the long end of a supply chain there. If it blows up, I don't know what to tell you. And it's heroically expensive. They're $4,000.
Yeah, they're
$4,000.
They do
have a new model
coming
out at the end of this year. Looks pretty good.
Okay.
But we're having a lot of problems with chargers. There is probably some liability in building a charger and releasing it because it, if you overcharge the cells, they
burn somebody's car down in the vicinity. That's right, in the vicinity.
It's not a hard engineering task. It's not as bad as a battery management system, but probably not as profitable either. You have to purchase some components. And the BMSs you can make for $2 and sell them for $2,000.
Yeah.
And so that's where they want to go.
Bunch of little boards, yeah.
So that's the current Waze charger, but we're still looking for the good one. We use the Elcons primarily here. They're inexpensive, but they're not very flexible. We have to order them.
Right, you have to pick the programs
to that voltage. Good value for the power. And reliable,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
but not very flexible. I'd prefer to have a programmable charger. What else are we doing? This is an interesting device I just bought on eBay, and it was non-trivial expense. $4,151.94. I got this from Glenn Fonzie.
Okay.
Apparently, after the movie and everything, Happy Days and that.
Yeah.
He's moved on to Bay City, Michigan.
Okay.
And is selling solar equipment. And this is a solar inverter. Solar inverter. It's called the Aurora photovoltaic inverter from Power One. And it is a 6-kilowatt inverter, and I've been looking for one of these for a year.
It's made in Italy. Can't be bad.
Yeah, made in Italy. Probably another long
supply chain.
Supply chain. But this is a device where you can hook up your photovoltaic array and provide it DC voltage, and it will convert it to 240 volts AC, or 208 or 120.
Okay.
Phase lock it with your grid at 60 hertz. And the advantage to that is then this works pretty well with the grid. Normally, if you lose grid power, it will disconnect the grid from your house. But as long as it's on there, as long as this is producing power, you'll use that. And if you don't produce enough, you get it from the grid.
Then it comes
if you produce too much, it runs your meter backwards and you get a little off your utility bill.
Right, okay.
And these have been developing and maturing for a long time. My first one was in 2000 in my home in Denver, and it literally would only switch on or switch off. Either way, it would run the meter backwards. And we did have net metering here. They were quite expensive. This is a 6-kilowatt version.
That's
in those days, yeah. I think 3 kilowatts was about as big as I could get. And so I had to have a bunch of them. It was about a 15-kilowatt system. So I think I had 4 or 5 of the Trace engineering inverters. Here's the problem. Most of them I've been looking at, and I've been shopping kind of hard for a year, use a DC input starting at about 250 volts and going up to 600. And then that'll produce 240 volts okay. AC. Several of our cars are 120 volts. The Redux is now 192. Uh-huh. This one will be about the same. So 250 volts doesn't do as much good. This one has an input value. It'll take two DC inputs up to 22 amps each from 90 to 530 volts.
Boy, that's wide and low.
It is wide. Low. Now, you don't get to full power below 180.
Okay.
But get
still,
power.
But you get power, yeah.
And you can have two 22 amp inputs, or you can parallel it for 44 amps of input, and it'll put out 6 kilowatts of 240 volts AC.
Okay.
Why am I on about this? A $4,000 device at that. A lot of our viewers are having trouble coming up with the Ducats to do the conversion. Well, this is a pretty handsome concept here. You put this in the garage. At $4,000 is less than some of the chargers, EVSE that they're charging. And you could hook your car up to this and use it as a battery backup for your house.
That's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty
now
cool.
Now you lose grid power, you hook up to this,
plug
and
your
you've
car
got
in,
6 kilowatts of power. Well, you can run most households on 6 kilowatts.
Yeah, most of just normal stuff to keep refrigerator running and TV and lights on.
Hell, it'll run an air conditioner, 6 kilowatts.
Yeah, for a while.
That's a pretty good, normally a backup generator would be like 12 or 15. You can get two of these and parallel them, but you have to have an isolation transformer for the second one. And that's $1,000.
That's a monster.
And they're huge devices.
Holy
but you could do it.
Yeah.
And so you could run your house on your electric car in a pinch.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Now, why do I like that? I've already got a generator at the house. We're always trying to drain down the cars to...
Well, we need a load.
Yeah, we need a load.
Yeah.
This is perfect. We'll hang this up. We'll let the car power the shop for a half a day, and I've drained the batteries down
pretty
for
good.
Some maintenance procedure to check something, to train a gas gauge or the Ziva 2 or whatever it is. And I don't just waste it driving around or running the heater.
Right.
We can power the lights and stuff with it in the meantime, or charge another car.
All kinds of stuff we could do.
There's a lot of things we can do by taking that energy out of the battery pack and putting it back into our AC power plant. This all goes back to, I'm reading an excellent book right now I recommend called Empires of Light. And it's the story of George Westinghouse, Thomas Edison, and Nikola Tesla.
Okay.
And it's amazing the interplay between them and the battle over DC and AC. Mm-hmm. People wonder why we're somewhat cavalier around the voltages and the electric cars. They're relatively safe as an electrocution concept. You can get a hand across 400 or 500 volts DC, and it's a mild tingle, and it's not really dangerous. The danger in electric car packs is actually from dropping a wrench and having it turn into a plasma ball from the current and getting a flash burn.
Yes, it burns lava all over you. Yeah.
Not you don't want to wear any jewelry around the batteries, wristwatches, and so forth. But it's not electrocution. Electrocution isn't the problem. AC, of course, you can be electrocuted by fairly low AC voltages, and that was the battle. Westinghouse had developed a means of transformers to transmit electricity quite long distances by stepping up the voltage and stepping it back down to go into the house. Edison liked low voltage DC buried in trenches in the ground, but that limited him to half a mile from the central plant. Then, two, no motors ran on AC. Prior to Nikola Tesla, who developed one, but it wanted to run on 60 cycles or even lower. And George Westinghouse had a whole system of 1,000 power plants in operation at 133 hertz. But when they went to do Niagara Falls, it all kind of came into place. And Westinghouse got the contract to build the generators and put that in.
That kind of settled it, huh?
And had to go to the 60 cycles to get Tesla's motor to work, you had to be able to run a motor. But we still kind of go back and forth between AC and DC, and conversion is a big issue. I had been looking for one of these in the 6, 8, 10 kilowatt size for some time, but they just didn't have a wide enough voltage range
low enough
on the input.
On the input.
And this one came up. Now, you got to be careful ordering this. They have a slightly less expensive one. It was about $3,800, but it starts at maybe 200 volts, 190 volts. This one starts at 90 volts and will make power. It won't reach full power till 180. And it'll take inputs up to 530. So
That's cool.
We have been working furiously on our test bench.
Yeah, they got a peek at it last week.
Matt tried to kill me with it here a little bit earlier today. You want to take a look? This is cool. We blew the lights out at one point.
Yes, we did.
And then we,
it's been a fun day, guys.
I think tore up a transmission. Let's take a look.
All right.
Masterflux proudly presents the Sierra Series brushless DC variable speed electric compressors. The Masterflux family of compressors are up to 40% smaller and lighter than competing belt-driven DC automotive compressors. Masterflux uses rare earth neodymium magnets for longer life and greater efficiency. The robust rotary design is ideally suited for rugged EV applications. With a scroll type compressor, the process begins with the refrigerant entering the evaporator from the suction side. Refrigerant then travels through a reed valve to the top of the compressor, where it is compressed at up to 8 times the incoming pressure before exiting out the discharge tube to the condenser. Masterflux compressors are available in 400 to 15,000 BTU per hour capacity range for multiple refrigerants, including 134A. Output can be manually adjusted using a simple 0 to 5 volt pot. Masterflux compressors are available to handle input voltages of 12 to 420 volts DC and come with a specific BLDC motor controller for each voltage range. The new Masterflux 2011 product catalog can be downloaded from their website at www.masterflux.com. Masterflux products are available in the U.S. from Revolt Customer Electric Vehicles, in Australia from EV Works, and in South Asia from EV World. Masterflux, the technically elegant choice for powerful electric air conditioning.
All right, we're going to talk a little bit about our test bench. You've been kind of working at it hard all week.
I have been.
A week of terror.
Yeah, it's just been, you know, long days or whatever, just a lot of wiring, cables, and dragging
We've
batteries.
We've got wires going everywhere. When they see this, I'm going to hear from everybody in Christ's kingdom about what bad wirers we are. It's mostly me. I've been in a hurry all week. I wanted to see it run. You know how it is.
And well, so did I. I was anxious to see it running. Mm-hmm.
We've got our Manzanita Micro PFC75 charger here that we're using to charge our AGM cells. That's kind of what it was designed for. It's not a very good charger for LiFePO cells, frankly. Mm-hmm. It doesn't hit the voltage very well, and the voltage moves around based on how much current you're doing.
Right.
But it's a monster. Mm-hmm. It'll put out 12 kilowatts pretty easily. The PFC 75, they're over $4,000 and pretty raw, but well built, just not great technology, particularly for LiPo cells, but it'll work. And maybe if we couple it with a finished charger on the Cadillac, that can be made a little better.
Okay.
You can't beat it for raw power. We're going to have a 93 kilowatt pack, 400 amp hour cells. 70 of them. Mm-hmm. May not put all 70 in the car, use a couple for testing and spares, but we're going to have a big pack. This thing would still be able to charge it in about 7 or 8 hours.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It's got a lot of power. So that's we've got it kind of hooked up. Here's your terminals and your slap switch.
Mm-hmm.
Got a little meter. We're reading 147.7 volts on our battery pack at the moment. We're not running. Let's talk about your generator. You've done quite a bit of work there.
Yep. So we have a 100 or a 300 amp, 1200 volt rectifier. Originally, we kind of started out with two rectifiers, 275s.
Right.
But you found this bigger one.
Well, we had mounted those on a heat sink, and they worked fine.
Yep.
They're absolutely and probably more than adequate.
Mm-hmm.
But I did run across this unit. It's got a built-in heatsink. It's all one module. Mm-hmm. It does 300 volts, 1200 volts, 300 amps.
Uh-huh.
It's called Power Semiconductor Electronic Bridge Rectifier SQL300A/1200V. And I'm kind of impressed with it so far.
Yeah, yeah.
Where's our positive terminal?
Yeah, so we've got our three phases coming in. Positive terminal.
You got that run around the back
comes
of the
right
bench.
Over here to our bus bar.
Into our spider web nest of cables.
The negative side comes down the back side of the motor here, and that's going into our shunt.
Okay.
So we can see how many amps this is putting out.
All right.
So that goes down through a contactor, which we can turn on and off with this switch here.
Okay. So that's off.
That's off, and that'll be on.
There it's on, and that shows us our voltage, and when you turn it on, it's hooked up to the battery pack. I'm really reading the battery voltage here, right?
Right, right.
Okay.
And so, yeah, and that just goes right back to our bus bar and charges our batteries right back up.
And this is our current meter here.
Mm-hmm.
This is a 75 millivolt, 500 amp meter. We have a meter here that we're not using. That's a 500 amp, 50 millivolt.
Mm-hmm.
And right now our shunt is a 500 amp, 75 millivolt, which matches this meter. I'll probably try to replace, this was what I had laying around, with a 300 amp 50 or 75 system.
Okay.
Because we're not going to obviously try to go over the 300 amps there. Let's talk a little bit about shunts, because a lot of people are confused about them.
Okay.
A shunt is when you're measuring current, particularly in high values, 500 or 1,000 amps, the way you measure current is actually indirectly. You measure voltage across a known resistance.
Mm-hmm.
And we know from Ohm's law that our voltage will be a function of our current divided by our resistance. But resistance gives off heat. We're going to consume power. But not if we consume a real small amount.
Okay, right.
And the way these shunts are built, they actually simply have metal bars, much like our straps on our...
Oh, the copper bar or whatever.
Right, yeah. on the battery straps.
Uh-huh.
And this one's got, five of these. And they will actually notch them a little bit. Here you can see they're ground out on the back. They have kind of a known resistance because of the metal used. And then they'll actually notch them to calibrate them, either cut a little slit in them or these have the back side ground off just a little bit. This is a 500 amp, 50 millivolt shunt.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means is that it has, if you had exactly 500 amps going through this, it would drop 50 thousandths of a volt, 50 millivolts, 0.050 volts, across that resistance.
Okay.
And so that's a very low value resistance, like 0.00015 or
something.
You're
not going to get any heat off of it.
Right. Mm-hmm. You're not going to really generate any heat because it's such a small but fairly accurate level of resistance. And so you see the two little screws here. That's where you connect your leads. And we've got our leads of this one connected to the one on the back side of the generator, which is just like this, except it's a 500 amp, 75 millivolt.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll at 500 amps on it, you would get 75 millivolts full scale. And so if you read, 75 divided by 5 or 15 millivolts, that would be 100 amps. And so you need a meter. Originally, these had Darcenval movements in them, little motors, actually.
Oh, really?
Very fine windings of wire that actually pull this needle, which is counterweighted inside, based on the amount of current through that tiny coil, which is driven by the 50 or 75 millivolts of voltage. That's how fine this gets.
Okay.
Today, a lot of them are digital. I'm kind of, an old meter guy because I can see trends. I can see changes. The digital gives a false sense of resolution and accuracy that it may not be that accurate, but it gives you a number so you feel good that you know exactly what it is.
Uh-huh.
But they sample and jump around, and you can't tell really what they are. So I like these needle things for the bench. But this is our generator control box. If we turn this off, there's no load on this generator at all. Mm-hmm. We can spin it quite freely.
Yep, yep.
It'll turn fine. It won't produce any current.
Mm-hmm.
But if we want to put a little bit of load on our system, we can turn that on. That connects it to the battery pack, and then it'll start generating current into the batteries.
Yep.
We'll show you our perpetual motion machine here in a little bit.
No joke.
But we're using shunts, which is one of the two techniques to measure current. The other one is the Hall effect transformer, which I like those current sensing devices as well. The shunts are probably a little more accurate, a little more temperature stable.
These ones here. Okay.
That's what we're using. We'll show you that on the back side. So we can generate power and put it back in our batteries.
Yes, we can.
I'm going to predict that we won't get quite as much out as we put in.
Are you sure?
I'm pretty sure. And I can even show you why.
Well, there's a lot of guys that think
we're going to heat up that transmission pretty good. Wasn't that what you were telling
me? That's true, yeah. It's getting a little warm.
We've got our bilge pump thing going pretty good.
Yeah, here's our fill reservoir.
Mm-hmm.
Comes down, goes to our cooler,
where
we've got a big fan on it. From there, it goes down to our water pump.
Here, you want to hear the fan?
It's a little
noisy. Can't talk while the fan's on. We won't need the fan most of the while, but we've got it.
And so that, the cooler to the water pump, our water pump is this big hose here, and this is pretty much where And we can take this big hose, connect it to whatever we want, run it back through. We've got a big long hose for the return, because eventually we're going to run it through this generator once we get our fittings on the end of that.
But right now that comes back into the bottle.
Comes right back in the bottle, and it's got pretty amazing flow. You'd be really you'd be really surprised how much is coming out of there.
We've it's kind of splashing around there.
You know, I'd say, well, what do we have here?
An AN16 would be an inch. So an AN8 would be a half an inch. And so what, AN6 would be what, 3/8?
I guess, yeah.
Yeah, so 3/8 of an inch tube.
Okay.
And that's plenty. And I'm amazed at how quiet our little Toyota Prius inverter pump is.
It's a great water pump.
And it moves the stuff through at a pretty good rate.
Yep.
We still have to get that hooked into here, but so far this is not.
Hadn't even gotten warm.
So that's what we've got going there. This is my Windows XP laptop.
Oh, Windows is good, isn't it?
You know, I just detest
Windows. Oh, you gotta love Windows.
However, Windows XP is the most common operating system. The newer Windows has not supplanted it. People have not adopted them. And almost all of our configuration software works on this.
Okay.
Again, as I mentioned earlier, we actually had the guys at CurrentWays tell me the reason that their charger didn't work, that their charger worked fine. I simply had the wrong operating system, the wrong computer, and the wrong CAN bus adapter, which was kind of curious since they provided the adapter. But I'm stuck with XP because most of the configuration software for the Brusa, the TIM 600, the Reinhardt, etc., is built for XP. And if I upgraded to Windows 7, I would have to have a separate computer just for that upgrade and still have an XP computer to do all this configuration. So to do an electric car, basically you need a little Windows XP computer, and there isn't any help for it. And you can be a Linux guy and you can be a Mac guy all you want, except when you're doing the devices on the car. When I say programming them, it's completely a misnomer. Configuring them, it's running a little piece of software they give you to enter some of the variable parameters that you can use to tune the device to your vehicle. And then that's all it is. It just runs a little programs, communicates with the devices, makes a couple changes, typically records those into a electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory, EEPROM, and you disconnect it, and it runs forever from there until you want to change it. And our Soliton One controllers, really all the controllers have them, but it's just something that comes up over and over that you have to be able to configure things.
Yeah.
Got your TCI transmission here. You've got added a couple of pieces of tubing. Tell us about it.
Well, those are the line output, or the cooling in and out. It goes to our two-way cooler when it's in the vehicle.
So this would normally go to a transmission cooler.
Exactly. I mean, we've kind of just got it. You can't just put a plug in it.
That's our fill tube. Oh, we didn't have these on last time.
Nope.
These are your little adjustment threaded rods. And what we do there, Matt spent a day with a drill drilling holes in multiple layers of quarter-inch angle iron. How did that go?
Oh, it was a couple hours worth of work. He's trying to get me talked out of steel, one drill bit at a time.
He came to me liking steel. We're going to have him into aluminum before this is all over.
Bet. I'm going to learn how to TIG just so I can drill through this steel.
But we ran these threaded rods, and you stuck a piece of pipe here, so these are sort of permanent, and we can just use these big nuts to raise and lower it, and that let you line it up pretty good with the transmission. Now, we don't really rely on that to hold it in place, right?
No. We've drilled a couple of holes on the underside here that goes through the two angle irons, and it kind of clamps the center.
Well, really, three angle irons. There's one that this is on, and then the two on each side. So you drilled the hole all the way through and stuck a 3/8 inch bolt.
Exactly. We went ahead and tightened those down.
Two here and two on the other side. Mm-hmm. So you were able to align the generator right where you wanted it.
Yep.
That way. And actually trim all four corners for height. And then we actually ran it a little bit.
Yeah.
With a 12-volt battery. And when it was vibration-free, you shot...
We shot bolts through it.
Shot bolts through here. Yep. If we wanted to do this over again, then we would basically move it and use the same holes, but we'd just have to drill another hole through the centerpiece, right?
And that's not too big a deal. Right. Yeah, little quarter-inch piece of steel, four holes, it wouldn't be too bad to do. Uh-huh.
And eventually we'll have so many holes in it that we'll be able to put it where we want
to.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll get to them as we can. Dad sent us some stuff. Well, tell me about it.
We have our yoke, which is... what was that? 1.5-inch shaft, 3/8 keyway,
right,
for our generator. This is an open-end yoke here on the left side, and it uses straps to hold the U-joint in. That way, we can take things on and off pretty easily.
So those straps are bolted on, and then you've got little clips. It looks like here holding in some of this stuff.
Yeah, those are. Once you put the U-joint in, there's a little groove, and that's actually where you put the clip in. You do both
like
sides.
Like a snap ring?
Yeah, it's just like a snap ring. Pretty much you put a joint in on each side, or one of the cups, put the clips in, and the joint will be really tight. You almost can't move it. You give it a couple of whacks with a hammer right in here. Do that on both sides. U-joint's as free as can be. Huh. That centers everything, kind of just walks everything where it's supposed to be.
So this thing's not going to disintegrate on me, because when I crank it up to 2,000 RPM and we're... sitting here on the panel, I don't want a lot of this stuff in my face.
No, you shouldn't have any problems.
good.
And then
a lot of our viewers are very concerned. Quite touched. They're very concerned about my personal safety.
They want you.
And one of them actually suggested I go to another room and operate it from there.
From the window room over there?
Yeah, we can go to another room and just sort of look through the window.
I guess that's not my style, but on the other hand, I
don't want to eat this thing.
So. And there's our the slip yoke there is what's on, they pretty much 400s, 4L80s, it's all that 32 spline. And that's actually the slip yoke that they use in the Transwarp 11 and the 9.
Right. We actually sent a Transwarp 11 that I bought from Alex Smith, I think, to Jim Husted and had George Hamstra send him a new one. And he used the two of them and put it together. We pulled the yoke off where we sent it because we didn't need that on the motor. But now we can use that on the tail of the transmission to hook up to our generator system. Cool. You've mounted my contactor box here.
Yep. So there we've got a shunt and a contactor in there, as well as a pre-charge resistor. We're not really sure if we're going to use that for what we got. It seems how these are...
Well, they don't need it, but a lot of controllers do, so we've got it. And that's over here. This is my Wanco control panel, and it's got some interesting features. One of them is this relay switch. This actually applies the 12 volts to the contactor and closes it, applying voltage to the two soliton ones. That contactor actually has a second set of contacts, and I don't see these very often, but I kind of like them. You can use those to tell when it's open and closed, really. Not when you opened and closed it, not when you sent it 12 volts, but when it actually, the contacts closed.
Okay. All right.
And so I've got a little light here with that. This is a fairly expensive device. It's a 5K pot. But it looks like a combination to a safe.
What's the combo?
And it's about a 20-turn pot that gives us a very fine control over 5 volts. And we hook that up to our 5 volts and ground from the soliton and take the wiper and send it to the solitons as our accelerator signal.
And that's a pretty heavy-duty pot, too. All the way through and through.
It is. We're handling no power here. But that's not the point. The point is to gain control.
You don't want some cheap pot running off on you, though.
Right.
So that's, good heavy-duty pot.
It's not spring-loaded. It's not like an accelerator. Mm-hmm. It's just a pot, but I can dial in a very precise value.
Yeah.
One of the things we've learned playing with this is that I like to know what the voltage is, and Matt has to sit there and get me a reading while I'm turning the pot. We're just going to put another meter on here for our throttle voltage. Ignition sends 12 volts to our solicons. Ignition. And they go through the process of booting up. So that's our contactor. We've got it on. We're sending power to the soliton ones. It's a little voltmeter. It's a 300-volt voltmeter, and I have it connected, actually, to just a couple clips. And I have them on the solitons right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's reading our 150 volts from our batteries, whether the relay's on or off. Why would that be?
Precharge resistor.
We have a 750 ohm precharge resistor bypassing that contactor that we don't really have power that would be useful to run the motor through that. But we will sense voltage through it, so this is always going to indicate our battery voltage. This is the 1,000 amp 50 millivolt meter.
Mm-hmm.
And in the contactor box, I already have a 1,000 amp 50 millivolt shunt.
Oh, that was 1,000 amp. Okay.
Right.
Good.
And so that's why this is here. We may, put in a second system that's a Hall effect for a smaller amount, say 50 amps or 100 amps, so we can get control of fine levels of current.
Okay.
But 1,000 amps. That's the max these are rated for. Of course, we have this on the path to two of them, but I cannot picture us actually putting 1,000 amps in them for this test bench.
Right,
it's
right.
Just not practical.
Right.
It's too high a level of power. If I turn the ignition switch on, you can see the lights flashing on the solitons, and they go through their boot up procedure. This little logger program that Martin at Evnetics did, I'm kind of impressed with it because I can take this and it just plugs in here and I can move it over here and it never misses a beat.
It
reestablishes
right back up.
Mm-hmm. And picks up whatever's coming out of that one.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really have to restart it or reset anything and so forth. We'll talk about that in a little bit. This is, if you notice, a tachometer. It's a 6,000 RPM tachometer that we had in the Speedster, but I wanted to be able to measure the 1,000 amps with the Ziva 2, so we swapped it out on a 10,000 RPM tachometer. We're not going to do 10,000 RPMs here, so this will work fine. This is two water gauge or water temperature gauges, and I've ordered some old little AN fittings with an eighth NPT port here. These are not hooked up to anything right now. And this is a 12-volt regular automotive 6 to 18-volt meter that just tells me that I have an appropriate amount of DC voltage. So that's kind of our layout. Right now we've got a couple of other little sensors here. This is a, I found this the other day at the hardware store. This is a DeWalt infrared sensor. And we've used these before, infrared sensors. But this one's just light. It's like a little pistol.
You
aim the beam.
Yeah.
It's got a nice display. I really like it. Yeah, this is one of these. This is just a temperature sensor that comes with. These are relatively cheap digital gauges, but they'll display water temperature.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so I can get a little fitting. This is a male-male. I've ordered a male-female. I can just stick this in here, tell the inlet and the outlet temperature here on our controllers, and display temperature as we operate. So this is a little DeWalt gun, infrared temperature. I can actually aim into the motor and kind of get a sense of what we're doing on our temperature on our commutator. I don't have a blower going yet. This is a Nico digital tachometer, and Brain has put me a piece of black tape with a piece of white reflector on it to where we can actually test the actual RPM of our motor. Now this is, when you're setting up something like this, it's kind of a bootstrap event. Mm-hmm. You have to start with something good, yeah, and then compare the other things to that. And we're already into a big mess with the solitons and our gauges and so forth, trying to sort all that out and find out what are the good numbers and then what are the ones that are off.
Right.
And so there we go. Let's see, what else is there to talk about? Well, you've got the solitons, both of them wired up. Of course, our whole theory with the Cadillac is a very unusual design. They often, with two motors, they'll use a controller and an elaborate contactor set to switch them between series and parallel operation.
Right.
If you operate two motors on the same shaft, and you wire it up in series along the whole, both motors, you wind up with the same current through both motors, but half the voltage on each one. And so you get very good low-end torque from the pair, because they both get the same amount of current. But they hit the wall on RPM, and the torque falls off fairly rapidly when the back EMF, or the generated electromotive force in the motor, starts to approach that you're applying. You can't get any more torque out of the motor. And so then they'll shift it into parallel mode.
Right.
Now in parallel mode, the controller applies the full voltage to each motor, and the current has a separate path, one to each motor. And so you only get half the current to each motor, but you get the full voltage.
Right.
And so that lets you go on up the torque curve from there. And that series parallel switching has been very popular. I like another idea. And that is, let's take a controller for each motor that'll do 1,000 amps. And we'll simply let them each have their own controller, but we'll configure the controllers to operate on the same inputs and hopefully match them closely enough in the same way. The soliton from Evnetix has a peculiar advantage, and I do not know of a controller that has this. Are there controllers where I could fake it? Really, probably not. There's some games you could play with the throttle input to make them idle, but they're kind of dangerous games, and they may not do what you think they'll do in all cases. Worse, our idle is not what you think.
That's true. Right.
Our whole concept is normally with an automatic transmission, you set an idle of 600 to 800 RPM, right? You're the transmission guys. What's the normal?
I would say, you know, usually probably 600, and then when you put it in gear, it might drop down to 500.
The problem is, we're going to have the pump on the transmission going, of course, but also our power steering and brakes are going to be driven by a pump on this end of the motor. Further, we're going to have an air conditioner compressor that may kick in and may not, kind of as commanded by the engine control unit. I've got no control over it,
right?
And that's going to put a load on it. So we want it to maintain a a fairly constant, it's not got to be a religion, but a fairly constant RPM.
Right, right.
All along. Epinetics has done some work with a little PID loop control system to maintain that RPM, sampling it and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little put off by what we found today, and that they don't measure RPM and they don't measure current very accurately
in their
software. But the process is still there, and it still works, and we can use it. We'll just have to adjust it using other inputs to get exactly what we want on the thing. So we wired up the Solitons. Matt's made up some beautiful cables that come back here and go to our motor in the usual series arrangement for each motor, but with each motor treated separately.
Right.
And because of the physical layout of this, we found we could put these straps on the motor to connect the armature winding and the field winding. And so we've done this a little bit oddly, I think, and connected A1 to S1, and then put the A2, the negative end, and the positive to S2. And so that's almost a little bit backwards, but it works essentially the same, and we get our clockwise motion of the from the aux end. I've always found it odd how they talk about rotation in these motors.
I know
it. And the net gain motor default is CCWDE, and that what that means is counterclockwise drive end.
Okay.
And the brushes are advanced to take advantage of that. And you can actually rotate them if you need to do it clockwise drive end or neutral, which is no advance at all.
But it can spin either direction.
Right.
Without any troubles, uh-huh.
And if you're gonna have your motor reverse or use it as a generator and try to do regenerative braking, you need to put it in neutral. But you get a little bit better brush action, a little less arcing and so forth with it advanced a little bit.
Okay.
Counterclockwise drive end. This is the auxiliary end. This would be the drive end. If I was facing the drive end and it was going counterclockwise, it would be turning this way. And so, of course, from the aux end, we want it to rotate in this direction. Our RPM is provided by a recharge car in Nashville. We put one on the Redux. They gave us one for our contest winner, and I've just stolen it.
Sorry.
Sorry about that. You're not going to get your pickup. I like these pickups. They're designed to bolt right to the net gain motor, and they have a little pickup and then a sleeve, and the number of little bolts in them is how many pulses it makes.
Yeah.
The bolts themselves are what makes the pulses. And so I like that. We're using four. We're going to have to put a whole thing on the end of it. And we're faking the crankshaft pulley by taking a power steering pulley. And Lucian is going to kind of core that and put a sleeve in where it'll go over here. So I'm not too sure where this is going to go ultimately.
Yeah.
And that's Matt's problem. I'm dying to hear how he worked that out. But we also got the power steering pump air conditioning, but this is our
Reluctor ring.
Reluctor ring
mm-hmm.
for the off the crankshaft. It was like $19. One of the advantages of GM is the parts are pretty inexpensive.
You gotta love that.
And so that's got to go on there too. So we've got a lot of work on the auxiliary end of our motor system to do. But today we have this hooked up and a little black tape where I can read RPM.
Mm-hmm.
The There was a case recently of a guy trying to do what we're doing, I think with some 9-inch motors.
Okay.
And I'm not protecting him. I simply can't remember the name of the company. It's supposed to be a West Coast converter of just absolute nothing but the highest skill. And they blew up their motor.
Jeez.
And the reason they did was they hooked up two solitons and they brought up one and calibrated the throttle.
Uh-huh.
Except the other one was on and hadn't been disengaged, and it started spinning the motor. They had no load on it, and it went in a very high RPM and destroyed the motors, both motors.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of bad news. The guy came on one of the forums asking for information, and when the people there, it was kind of a vague description of the problem, started asking him questions. He said he couldn't answer it because, that would reveal the guy who had done it.
Mm.
And he didn't want to put his name out there because he would be embarrassed.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the soul Evnetics guys said, well, we know who he is, and gave out the name.
And, it's a cruel world.
Yeah,
out
it's
there.
A cruel world. No, a bunch of stuff. The problem is professionals, learn from their mistakes, and amateurs are like cats. They bury their poo-poo in the sandbox. And so that's a pretty good sign. If you run into somebody that knows everything and has never made a mistake, don't let them work on your car, and don't buy a car from them. That's just a good practice. It's kind of like if it sounds too good to be true, it
is.
Yes. If you talk to somebody that is an expert at electric cars, which at this young stage of having actually batteries to make one that's any good for a couple of years.
Uh-huh.
If you run into somebody that's done it for years and is an absolute expert, get away from them.
Uh-huh.
They don't know what they're talking about, and they're going to hurt you and the car both. The people that are plowing the ground have burned up plenty, and I'll be happy to tell you tales
what not
of
to
it
do.
And what not to do to do that. So that's. But anyway, there's some care in order in dealing with dual controllers. We just disconnected the battery from one of them, did the other one, and then did the first one. Obviously, you want to get on with the software and disable the controller as if you were doing the throttle, and then go to the other one and disable it too.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that would avoid the problem. But why go through all that risk? We can simply disconnect the battery from one of them, and it's going to error out, but we're working on the other one anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And then we disconnect that one and hook it up and do this one, and it's fine. One of the interesting things we're going to do is that because of this PID algorithm, which is a little bit random in how it kind of a PID is for progressive, integrative, differentiating. It's a way of leveling out hysteresis so you don't overcorrect things.
It, okay.
Sort of integrates it and differentiates it and does a couple of other things to formulaically adjust things around a value without hunting.
Okay.
And they've done a pretty good job of that. But if we had both of them trying to idle our system, I think there would be problems.
I think they might fight back and forth a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. They would start feeding each other, and that would not be good. They might work it out, depending on how good the PID algorithm is. They might work it out. But why? If we're idling, we obviously don't need full power.
I guess we're going to have to see if one's more efficient, running both, see if running two is more efficient than running just one by itself.
I'm not even interested.
Yeah.
At that power level, and unfortunately, we're going to use some power idling because of the overhead of these transmissions, the pumps in them, and so forth. But that's the price we pay for the buffering of that torque converter and that automatic transmission, and to have 6 gears to select from.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that applies whether we are able to use the 6L80E that's in the Cadillac or if we have to go to the TCI that we have here on the test bench. Mm-hmm. Either one of them would be okay, but there's is an overhead in efficiency. We already know from running this, our case got up to maybe 135 degrees Fahrenheit, just running it at 1500, 2000 RPM. Mm-hmm. And that's loss of energy.
Yeah.
And so that the automatic transmissions are heroically efficient, I no longer quite buy into. They are a load, and we'll pay a price in range by having that. But our air conditioner will work pretty good.
And the only time you're really just sitting there would be idling. So at a light, really. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really the only time. And once you're going down the road.
I kind of like it that my electric cars don't do anything when I'm at a light.
For sure.
In park and traffic. Yeah. But this is, you know, I really think this size vehicle, and it's a luxury vehicle. I'm not going to be able to get it with a 5-speed transmission in it.
Mm-hmm.
Manual. They don't make Escalades with 5-speed.
We can do it.
Well, actually you could, but what happens to my cup holder?
Well, you got a big shifter sticking out where they were. Yeah, those were.
So where do I put my coffee cup? You're still not with the whole concept here, man. I know you're stuck on the 7-second 0-60. Picture coffee cup, air conditioning blowing up
cooling my pant legs.
Right? Power window and the cigarette, okay?
All right.
That's what an Escalade's about. Yeah, it's really not about the transmission at all or efficiency. If I wanted efficiency, we'd be doing a smaller car. And so that's kind of where we're at. So what we've done is set this one up to idle and this one not.
Okay.
And we have calibrated because we have this nice vernier control and a good voltmeter, I can measure fairly precisely, and we've set it up for a 1 volt minimum and a 4 volt is our maximum throttle, and done them both identically. Mm-hmm. With identical levels of current and power and so forth to the motors, and I'm pleased to report that they operate great. And one of them will run the thing fantastically.
Yeah.
At idle.
Uh-huh.
There is an anomaly, and I don't like it, but I see why they did it. The Evnetics guys, they're pretty good with the electronics and the software. They struggle a little bit with conceptuals.
Okay.
Like what it would be like to use their product.
Mm-hmm.
To idle it, you first have to press on the accelerator to get to the idle RPM and then release it.
That is a little goofy.
Isn't it? One of the things we need to keep in mind when doing an electric car is not to make it quirky.
Right.
Your daughter ought to be able to get in your electric car and it operate just as she would expect, which she gets from the conventions that have been developed over 100 years. In operating a car, and that does not include pressing on the accelerator to get the idle to come on.
That might even take me a while to figure out if I didn't know.
Yeah.
What the hell?
And we should be able to use the start signal from the ignition switch,
right.
Not the ignition on, but the start signal to initiate this idle.
Talk about an electric car feeling normal.
Mm-hmm.
You get it on and click it over to start for a second
and
let it start.
You can't start unless you're in park.
Uh-huh.
Or neutral.
Right.
And so that pretty much takes care. The safety thing, guys at Evnetics, they've already gone through all this.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to fix it for them.
Evnetics Electric Vehicle Systems presents the Soliton One Controller. 1,000 amps of continuous power at up to 340 volts. Enough power to drive your dream car while automatically protecting your precious battery pack. Built-in contactors and pre-charge circuit reduces parts count. Each Soliton One controller undergoes rigorous dynamometer qualification. An easy-to-use web interface configuration with real-time data logger through an Ethernet connection. the only controller with programmable idle function ideal for automatic transmissions. Liquid cooling for high power operation. Evnetics Soliton 1. Very dangerous, very high voltage.
Yeah. So here we are. Matt, what have we got our transmission in?
It's in park right now.
In park. Do we want to start in park or in drive, or what do we want to do?
Let's get an idle going.
Okay.
And then we can try reverse. We can try neutral. So we're in park now.
Okay. You want to come run it, or you want me to?
I'll let you run that, and I'll shift it here.
Okay. I've got a couple of ways of getting out of this. And one of them is if I turn off my ignition switch, the Soliton should shut down. If I shut off my relay switch, it doesn't matter if they shut down. They're not going to get any more power except through a 750 ohm, about a 20 watt Vichy that'll blow up if they try to draw any current. And finally, I've got my slap switch over there, which I can get to in case we come unraveled. This is my potentiometer for 0 to 5 volts. And so we'll just start turning that up slowly. And to get to a volt is several turns of this vernier. I can hear something happening.
And we're starting to turn.
I'm starting to get a little RPM here. Not on my tack. And here we come. I'm showing about 700-800. I'm going to back off.
Okay.
And it's kind of taking off on its own. I'm showing right under between 500 and 600 RPM on my tachometer. Let's go take my Nico. And if I can get that red dot right on that white spot, it tells me that we're doing 654 RPM.
Okay.
Our Evnetics thinks it's doing about 750. That's kind of a problem. I've actually had to set the idle for 850 in the Evnetics to get about 650 on the system because it's a little bit off.
Okay.
Let me turn this up. See if I can get 1,000 here. Right at 1,000. This is reading about 900.
Okay.
910. Okay, yeah, we've fallen off here, too.
Go down
too.
A little bit. Okay.
We'll bring it up. Again, I think that's about 1,000. See what I got here. Just showing 1,000. There's 986.
Now we're speeding up a little bit, yeah.
Now it's taking off on me, 1176. looks like 1,000 to me. 1,058.
Okay.
1,053. So we're about 50 RPM, maybe higher than our pack. But our Evnetics is telling me 1,180, 1,200, 1,170, 1,200, and jumping around a little bit. So I don't quite trust their RPM action. If I turn this all the way down, I go into a idle mode. I can actually go to my off Soliton. See if that picks up. There it is. And I am at 0 amps. I can actually turn this up where it's working a little bit. There, I've got 10 amps or so. And then turn down from there, it's zero. Now, we're idling entirely on the right-hand Soliton. This is a PID algorithm. And this left hand is not passing any current at all. It's at zero. But I still get an indication of 730, 740, which is a good 100 too high. We're showing 650 here.
Okay.
And so that's our idle, which is what I wanted. I had to put 800 into the Soliton configuration to get 650 out of it. But this all works.
Okay.
We can do this. Why don't you put her in gear?
All right, what we're gonna do, we'll start off with reverse.
Reverse?
That's reverse there.
Okay.
We haven't turned our load on yet. It's just kind of free. The generator's kind of freewheeling right now.
No, I've got it on.
Oh, okay.
We're at 600 still on our thing. All right, our generator's off.
Okay.
We're showing 740 here. This looks like 600, well, just under it, 580 or so.
Okay.
This is showing 546, 635, 634, 636, about 630.
Okay.
And that's pretty good. We're right at 600 on here, so I like this. This is showing 700. That's a little high.
Okay.
On our Soliton inputs. What's your temperature doing there on the transmission?
Oh, I'd say about 132.
All right. Let's see what I'd say. How about 123?
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
120, 123. This, which needs liquid cooling and isn't getting it, of course it's not really generating, is at 70 degrees. Got my bilge pump on. My Soliton at idle is at 70 degrees. 69.6. So we're not hurting too bad.
All right, you wanna try one of the forward gears?
Yeah, or? Let's do a forward.
Okay.
I'm going to turn off our load
here.
We're
going to go back to neutral there. And there's forward.
Is that first gear?
That's first gear.
At idle. Right at 600 on the tank. .636 on the gun.
Okay.
.730, .740 on the Soliton. So my tack and my gun seem to be working pretty well.
All right.
I'm not hardly showing any current draw here.
Okay.
Yet. In fact, we have zero into this one. Let's start, let's turn on our load a little bit. And crank this up some. Everyone's afraid this bench is going to fold up on me like a weed whacker and throw us both through the thing. You might. Well, I see you got your safety.
I got
your safety glasses on. We'll be.
We're
fine.
All right. We're all right. Any RPMs yet? I'm showing 1,000 there, 1,026.
Here's 1,000 for me.
Okay, I'm at 1,070 right now.
All right, so this is reading about 50 or 70 low.
Okay.
This one's reading 12, 1,400. That's quite a bit. No real current out of here. We can see our battery voltage here, 140 volts. Our battery voltage here is about the same, and that makes sense. They're going to be no real current out, maybe 20 amps going in.
Okay.
Now, we're showing 90 amps here. I don't know what that means, but we're not drawing 90 amps, as best I can tell. Pretty steady 1,500. What do you got on the gun?
Okay. 1,550 RPM. Yep.
We've got a little vibration going here.
Yep.
I have about 80 amps coming out of our generator.
Okay.
At 134 volts maybe, going into our battery pack.
All right.
We're drawing, I would say, 115. Well, no, that's those are 20s. About 130 amps, and here I'm showing 186 amps.
Yeah.
Which doesn't make any sense. And if I go to the other one. I'm showing 183 amps, 186
amps. At least they're measuring close to each other.
It thinks they're measuring quite closely. This showing 1770. Oh, excuse me. 1740. We look nailed up here at about 1450. I'm guessing, I think the, I got 1533 here, 1526. Okay. We're just over 1500 RPM. This is fairly accurate. This is total nonsense.
Yeah, okay.
I'm showing 180 amps on each of these. When I really have about 130 amps on the two of them together. I don't know what to make of that.
Yeah, I don't know.
I really don't. And so with 130 amps in, we're getting 80 amps out, and perpetual motion has failed me again.
We almost got it this time.
Yeah, we almost got it this time.
We now know one more way not to get how to do it.
What is that?
Oh, I think a wrench just fell off, I think, or something.
Don't scare me. We don't want to go viral. Those bolts from?
Those are plugs for the cooler.
Ah, okay. I'm showing 2,000 RPM there.
Okay. Yeah, you're a little over 2,000 right now.
2,080 is what I see here.
That's about what you see there.
Adjust it down to 2,000.
Okay.
Tell me when you're there. All right, we went viral.
Shit. What the fuck was that? What was going on? I couldn't even see it. I just slapped to that.
I don't know.
Shit.
Are we having fun?
Yeah. You know, I guess if things get vibrating and it's fast enough, that vibration will just keep getting louder, you know, bigger and bigger. Maybe that's what happened. Our harmonics just got too out of control.
You think?
Could have been. Could be.
We'll see if it turns at all.
Yeah. Whew. Yeah, that is a whiz.
I think we've torn something up.
Is it not going?
Well, not yet, because I'm not knowing it.
I'm going to put this in park. Okay.
I wish you'd have left it exactly where it was.
It's still there then. What RPM are you spinning out there? There it goes.
Something's different.
I don't think you have enough RPMs. Because it might. You have the load on the generator off, you say?
I have it off. Now put it in park.
Okay. I'll need you by the slap switch, because once he gets it up there, I'll probably try to put it in reverse and see what it does.
What gear was it in?
First.
It's in the transmission of the generator. Huh? Yeah.
Bogging down more than it was before, huh?
Yeah. Quite a bit.
Because it was really spinning. Okay. Let's try neutral. And then here's forward. This is where it might be ready to go. Yeah, it almost kills our motor. Yeah. Shut that down. Yeah. I guess we need to pull these two apart to see if the generator's freewheeling and the tranny's not. I still think this thing was getting too hot.
At 140 degrees?
For what we're doing? Yeah. I still think it was getting too hot, but not that it's overheating and caused something, but what's causing all that heat? You know, what's that? Mm-hmm. yeah, we're not overheated per se, but it's too hot for what it's doing. Something's dragging, or I don't know. Smell this fluid and see what it smells like. It smells good. You can smell burnt stuff usually in the fluid. Still smells fine. Yeah.
Put it in reverse again.
Okay. Are we drawing a lot of amps?
No.
No. Okay. It's definitely bogging it down. Transmission.
I can hear the problem.
Yeah, you can definitely hear it.
You can real low.
Not over here.
Are you hearing it from there?
Yeah, it's inside here.
Well, that sort of sucks. So what's the deal with the transmission, man?
I don't know. You know, we're seeing a little more temperature than I thought we would. Mm-hmm. That could be something bound up. You know, who knows? Maybe they got one of the one-way clutches in backwards or something. You know, we haven't tested all the gears. What mm-hmm. we've ran is basically just first and reverse. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we have electronics hooked up, but nothing, you know, no throttle position sensor or anything like that. Mm-hmm. We haven't even tried to shift it. Just first gear, reverse.
Right.
And so whatever, you know, whatever's going on, you know, something's definitely catching there.
Well, you've sure thrown off my test bench.
The what?
You've sure thrown off my test bench.
Hey, at least we don't have to pull it out of the car.
Well, yeah, you're right.
So this is actually a good thing to find this out now.
Huh. So you think it's something internal to the transmission?
I think so. You know, as hot as it was getting, and that's the thing, you forget a clutch or a... Or not a clutch, you know, one of the little bearings, one of the flat bearings in between something. Clearances are too tight, you know, whatever. It's going to cause some heat, and that could cause mm-hmm. a problem.
What's the next step?
We probably ought to send it back to them and see, you know, we could take it apart, but it's not going to do, you know, that'll probably void the warranty or something with them, so.
Well, call them and tell them what's happened.
Okay.
And I don't think we've had it over about 2,000 RPM.
No, I don't think we were.
First and reverse, and we got a shell temperature of 140 Fahrenheit, which is not, I know you thought it was alarming for what we were doing. I don't think it's much above body temperature.
We're nowhere near over temp for the transmission, but I think we're quite a bit hotter than we should be for what we're doing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, I know we don't have we just got this little cooler, but this, we've already shown this isn't much of a load right now.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, we can flip the switch on and off. It's not that hard of a load.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'll get a hold of Chris over there at TCI and see what he thinks.
All right. Okay, well, that's our test bench. We've already blown something up. Cool.
Success. Or failure. Depends on how you look at it.
You weren't having as much fun as Andy Eagle.
Oh, hell no. Oh, hell no.
All righty. Well, let's get back to our show.
Right.
Net Gain Motors, home of the Warp, Transwarp, and Impulse Motors, introduced the improved Warp 9 motor. The Warp 9 is a 9 1/4 diameter series wound DC motor with a double-ended shaft featuring 26 improvements for 2010. Externally, the terminal studs have been enlarged from 3/8 to 1/2 inch diameter. Bigger is better. On the inside, a larger commutator, new brush composition, and split brush design with heavier springs handle even higher voltages and currents than before. Our new fan increases airflow by almost 50% over typical paddle-style fans. And all this translates into improved performance. For even more performance or larger applications, take a look at NetGain's Warp 11 motor. an 11¾ diameter series wound DC motor for even greater torque and power. Since 2002, NetGain Motors has been leading the EV industry with precision, performance, and price. Visit us at go-ev.com, NetGain Motors, warp power to go.
If you make a loud noise, that young man can step lively, can't he?
I've never seen Matt move so fast.
He got kind of excited about
that. He jumped up and down, and it was pretty good. Yeah. Oh, I don't know what in the
heck. He never had that much fun in San Diego. What are you talking about?
No, I don't know what in the heck. He'll never leave.
What was the guy from Ottawa, Anthony?
Anthony, yes.
Anthony Bagnulo is now going to work for, I think he's going to work for Azure Dynamics.
Hitting in Mississauga.
When he sees this... video, he'll wish he was back here. They don't have fun in Mississauga we do.
That's right. You can work for Azure Dynamics all you want. They don't blow stuff up. Maybe they do. Maybe they have fun up there.
Maybe. You just never know.
That's right. They don't put it out on video.
So that was kind of cool.
Man. Be interesting to see what happened, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. That tranny, who knows?
What else we got?
That's kind of it. It's been a long week. We've been, working on a lot of stuff. We've got things coming up. We're going to be bringing the cars out maybe to a show or two coming up in the summertime. We'll let everybody know what's going on with that. And
we're going to try to go to the Kit Car and European Import Show. At Carlisle, Pennsylvania, in the middle of May.
Yeah, I think it's the 20th through the 22nd.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that will let us show off a little bit some of our speedsters and spiders and so forth. That should be fun.
Yeah. Let people see it in person, and that and the people who actually do the who build the regular ice versions of the speedsters and stuff will get a good look at an electric version.
The contest closed this week.
Yes, the contest closed.
We have got that shut down on the website now.
That's right.
We're not going to accept any further entries. We, I believe, got 955 entries that were completely filled out. And Brian is trying to figure out a way to make that into something I can go through and make sense of.
I got it into a Word document finally.
Did you?
It took four different conversions and a little bit of manual stuff, not much, but it's in something now that we can get off and take a look at and then get to our sponsors.
Okay. We're going to pick out 100 of them, you, me, and Matt.
That's going to be fun.
And that's going to be something. And then I want to send that
we'll be in tears.
To all of our contest sponsors.
Yeah.
And that would be Masterflux, of course, Evnetics, with the Soliton 1, NetGain, George Hamstra, and the Warp 9, which he's contributed, and a Recharge Car.
Sure, let's get them involved. Let them have some of the fun.
The little magnetic thing. Okay. By the way, order one. I stole the one
I
for the
saw
contest.
I tried to hide it from you, and
we got to get another one.
You can't find anything you're looking for, and you could find that. So I don't know. I failed.
Yeah.
Sorry, Josh, but you sold another one.
Yeah, we'll just buy another one.
I know.
And then that'll be for the contest winner. I guess that will do it. We're going to let them each take the 100 and pick out two or three.
Yeah, I think we're going to take it down. I think we told everybody to take it down to 10.
10?
Yes, yeah.
We will notify the 10 finalists and ask for their further input of video, photographs, write-ups, song, dance, and offers of bribes and other things
to our
viewers.
Yeah, that's right.
And then we're going to put it up for a vote by our viewers.
And we'll let you guys do it.
I'll let you all pick the winner. And then we will make the announcement. I guess invite them to come see us. If they don't want to, we'll still send them the stuff and get them started. But a number of them seem willing to video their progress for the thing. And some of them are probably better qualified to do that than I am.
That's right, we are. So have at it, guys.
I've got one other thing. Christopher Fisher has kind of joined us as a
consultant
on the website. That's Christopher thought that we really needed a topical index so he could find stuff in our videos.
We really do.
I've heard this a lot. Actually, we could use something.
Yeah, so I can't find stuff. I was looking for something the other day and I couldn't find it.
The problem is, as Christopher is learning, it's a Herculean amount of work at this point. We have 100 hours of video or better
yeah,
up on the website. And so compiling all that is a bit of a task. Eric Chris had done a pretty good one, but Christopher is actually putting up a website that has the videos, the blog, the links. It may be a better website than we're doing.
That's pretty
and
good.
I may just take a couple weeks off and watch and see how Chris does.
Just see what he's doing.
I can't wait to see what his video looks like.
Yeah, that's right.
But anyway, he's doing a great job putting together kind of an index function that we'll add to our website. You'll be able to go find links and look up various
good
items.
That's going
to
be cool.
An index to the various shows. I don't know what the final format. He's been working at it and has found that it's quite a bit of work. But the results, I've already linked it to our archive pages. And you can go there now and tell Chris what a mess he's making of it. And offer your
you go ahead, yeah, give him
really
your
like
help. he'll thank you like we do.
I think it's gorgeous, and I'm using it now.
Yes.
So. That's a welcome addition. Yeah. It's okay to help. We get a lot of suggestions for what we ought to be doing. But
no one ever helps.
It's not often that I get somebody that can do it.
I know. Yeah, we get a lot of suggestions. All the things that are wrong and no help.
Right.
Thanks.
we get some. I like to say, Eric, Chris.
Yeah, you know he did.
What else are we throwing around out there? I've talked with George a little bit. I want to do, Eric Chris suggested that we do a build school. And we're not going to do a 3-day build school where we build an EV. That doesn't work for me. But I think what I would like to do is kind of an open house with some classes and speakers, the way we used to do ISPCon.
Okay, some educational stuff.
Educational stuff, some barbecue stuff, some beer and whiskey stuff. We'll let them get liquored up, play with some high voltage, and go for a drive.
And then go for a drive. Okay.
Yeah, that's. So we're going to basically have the EVTV Invitational and have people come in. We're going to charge you a fortune for it, probably $500-$600 ahead.
Mm-hmm. And we'll do a lot of good stuff, though.
And probably, check with the ISPCon guys. They got real anxious to get their check in early on that deal. On an event. I'm shooting for September because the weather's so good here.
It's nice. Yeah, it'll cool off a little.
If it grew, we would have to move it into the summer where it's kind of hot because we live in a college town and they have all the facilities. But they're available in the summer. But we could start out with 20 guys in September. They have some campfires, some barbecue, play with electric cars, play with the test bench, and hear from people like George Hamstra and so forth on where the industry is going and you know what motor developments are going to be.
Yeah, some top secret stuff.
We'll have us, of course, but. Hopefully I can entice several other luminaries from the field to come in and speak at this and be part of it.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
And
we have done this before, guys, so it'll be good.
We have done it before. I want to start it small this time.
we want to have some fun.
They get crazy when they get big, but when they're the first couple of meetings are fun.
The fun ones, yeah. Yeah, okay.
That's good. The good ones. And then when it's 5,000 people, I don't really want to go to it anymore.
No, it's a lot of work.
So that's pretty much what we're doing and planning and working on right now. There were no fatalities on the test bench this week. I know a lot of you are concerned, and
maybe
clearly
the transmission.
For good reason now. I see what you're saying, but we're going to continue to live BMS-free one day at a time, and somewhat dangerously, but we're having fun, and if it gets me, I won't smile.
That's right. EV grin.
Until next week, I'm Jack Rickard.
And I'm Brian Noto.
Talk to you later.